Hey, you got a client that's getting under your skin? It's freaking annoying. That's probably why you clicked on this video, and that's why I'm making this video. A bad client can literally destroy your business, all the momentum that you've built, and even worse, cost you thousands of dollars. And that's what I want to help you avoid. So in this video, I'm going to talk about ways that you can identify nightmare clients from hell, like literally from hell, and how you can remove them from your business. These are the two things. I want you to get rid of the toxic clients in your life. I want you to avoid working with them altogether. It's not a foolproof plan. It's not gonna be a way to completely avoid it 100%, but it's gonna be a way to spot it as much as possible. And so I wanna jump into this video right now and give you some amazing tips that are gonna help you. But first, I need to tell you a quick story. So you're probably here watching this because you've had a nightmare client or two or 10 or 100 in your career, and you're trying to figure out ways that you can get better clients and avoid those nightmare toxic clients. I need to tell you a quick story first so I can give you some context of just one that I had fairly recently of a guy that came into my office and caused a lot of drama. And this is ultimately why we want to stay away from nightmare clients is drama. We don't need drama in our businesses. We need peace, we need fun, we need joy, we need unity. We need all the things that are gonna help our business grow and help us level up. And avoiding toxic, drama-driven people is really important. So this guy came in and he had called, I think, off of one of our Facebook ads or one of our ways. He found us on Google, was looking for a logo design company. This was a few months back. And he called and got on the phone with somebody on my team. Then he went through our onboarding process and he scheduled a time to talk with me. I get on the phone with him, and one of the first things out of his mouth, he started telling me the story about one of my competitors, who he mentioned their name, in town, who had been just such a horrible guy, horrible company. They did terrible work, and he was so disappointed, and he spent all this money, and how bad it was. And I get it. I have empathy for clients. People get taken advantage of on the client side of our industry all the time. And so I understand that people have to vent and they have to get that out. But where it really took a turn for me is when he started bashing this guy, and then come to find out later in the conversation is the guy fired him as a client. I said, man, I know this guy personally. I know the kind of business that he does. He's been in the community for a long time doing a lot of really great work for other clients that I've had from the past. I've taken clients from him. He's taken clients from me and vice versa because we're both very, very good at what we do. And he was bashing this guy. And I was like, there's just something just doesn't feel right about that. So I hesitantly agreed. He needed help with a small project for his ATV company. I hesitantly agreed to help him with this small little project. And it was just a little logo design revision. And I set him up with my lead designer in my office to come in and sit down and actually work with him. And it was through that one-on-one working that he did with that my designer that we came to the realization that this guy is a royal pain in the you-know-what. He was an absolute difficult person. Everything had to be his way, his time, and he was just extremely demanding. And it ended up becoming one of those situations where my designer's like, please, I don't ever want to work with this guy ever again. And that's the moment that I knew I had to try to eliminate him. And so there was going to be an interesting conversation that had to happen. But before that happened, he actually got on the phone with my business partner and she talked to him on the phone. And in that conversation, he disclosed that he had a criminal past. She calls me up, tells me this guy's got a criminal past. I said, oh, really? Well, that prompted me, because we weren't too far down the road with him yet, to do a little bit of a search. And when I did a search, I found out that there was embezzlement and fraud and writing bad checks and assault and battery. I mean, we're talking about physical battery, things that are going beyond just emotional now. We're getting into the physical. And so I knew immediately I had to make a phone call to this guy and tell him we're out. So knowing that this guy was not only just a bad client and a client from hell, but he was also dangerous. So this is something I had to take seriously because it's my job to protect my team. My team is like my family. I spend over 40 hours a week with them, right? So I knew I needed to protect my team and keep this guy as far away from us as possible. So I picked up the phone and I called him, and I just very politely, kindly, I wasn't rude. I said, hey man, I really appreciate you calling. I really appreciate the opportunity to help you out. Did we serve your needs? Did we handle what you needed handled on your logo design change? And he said, yes, I'm very happy. Your guy was awesome. Thank you so much. I said, okay, great. With that being said, I gotta give you some unfortunate news. Some things have happened in our business. We've been looking at some things, and unfortunately, I'm not gonna be able to service your account. I'm not gonna be able to work with you. We're just not a fit at this time. and boy, was he upset. Oh man, I'm so upset, Adrian. Oh, I'm so disappointed. I can't believe this. Does this mean I gotta start my search all over? And what am I supposed to do? And he was just, I could tell he was not happy. And it makes me uncomfortable to have to let people down like that, but it was my team over him. And it's always gonna be like that. So it goes without saying that he was really, really disappointed and frustrated with us, and I think his overall experience with dealing with marketing and graphics companies. So a couple days later, and this is where it starts to get really interesting, I get a phone call from my business partner again, sending me a recording as well, saying, listen to this recording. And this man decided to call up my business line and berate a brand new employee, like berate her, like full blown yell and scream at her on the phone. And the worst part about it is it was her first day. And this is where I got really upset. And to be honest with you, I'm gonna keep it real with you here because you guys are kind of like my other family, is I didn't handle it that well. I got really upset. I felt really protective, especially with a brand new employee who I had, you know, put a lot into and I have high hopes for. She's still with us today, thank God. But he was extremely rude and disrespectful to her and to us and really said some really horrible things about us. And that recording I still have. And so I had to step in and make a phone call to that guy and said, don't you dare ever call anybody in my company ever again. We're done. You have no business calling me. We're not doing any more business. And the conversation got heated and it escalated. I ended up in the turn having to call his business partner who he was talking a big game about, who was a lawyer, and tell him exactly what happened, explain the situation, and the lawyer said, I'm gonna take care of it, don't worry about it, it's handled, you'll never hear from us again. But thankfully, I was able to wipe that situation out and just remove it from our company, but it didn't come without some struggles and some headaches and some pains in the butt. And so after that, I really looked at the situation and said, from this crisis, how can I really improve my process? How can I get better to prevent people like this from coming on board? And that is where it leads into the conversation with you guys and some things that I want to share to help you guys in your business. But first, I want to know, did this story resonate with you? Have you had a nightmare client? I'm sure you have. I want to know about it. I want to hear about it. Drop a story down below. It doesn't have to be super long, but tell me about a nightmare client that you have and how did you handle it? Or maybe you have one right now and you need help. So the tips, these are the 5 tips that you need that I'm going to share with you guys today that are super important to figure out who these drama, toxic, clients from hell are, that you can avoid, how to find them, and then how to eliminate them for your business. So I'm gonna give you these 5 tips, and then we're gonna go into how you can eliminate them. So here are the 5 things that you need to be looking out for with nightmare clients. Number 1 is they love drama, and they talk about people very poorly. When you get somebody that calls you up and starts bashing somebody, and not just bashing their company, but bashing their personal character, that's a big red flag. You need to really take a step back and listen and ask some good questions when those things start to happen. Well, how did this affect you personally and why are you so upset about it? Sounds like this really bothered you. Sounds like this really impacted you. Why do you think that it bothered you so much? And try to pry a little bit, get a little bit more information, and maybe they really were done dirty and maybe they spent their last dollar on this designer or this creative agency or whoever and they're feeling really hurt and they don't have a lot of trust. I understand that, but when they're just talking and sharing and spreading drama just to share drama, that is what you wanna look out for. So that's the first thing. That's the first thing you wanna look for to avoid is the people who love drama. The number 2 thing you wanna look for is they get very emotional. They get very rude, they get emotional, they get agitated very quickly, and they just constantly, they'll flash on you. Like I think there was a point in time with that guy where one of my business partners didn't call him back within like a day or two. He contacted us like on a Friday and left us a voicemail at like 4:30 in the afternoon and hadn't heard back by Monday and sent me this long, ranting, emotional text message. That was another flag for me, something that made me go, huh. And so that's why it sparked the conversation with Amanda, which led her to telling me about what he had disclosed about his criminal background. And so really understanding how people react to situations and testing people even and letting that 24 hours go by. If I hadn't let that happen, if we had happened right away, we may have not picked up on that. But he got very rude and very emotional about things. And when people are making decisions from emotion, they're not making it from a sound place. You want to make your decisions from a logical place, not an emotional thing. So this is something you really need to be looking out for. The 3rd thing that you should be looking out for is people that are extremely demanding. No, do this. No, do that. You are not an order taker. As a designer, You are there to provide a creative service, to provide ideas, to provide direction, and you are the authority. You are the trusted authority in your space. They hired you as the professional to do the job. They are not the designer. When the client starts to try to take over and be the designer, this is when you need to take a step back and say, hey, I understand that you want this to look a certain way, but it's very important that you let me do what you're paying me to do. You paid me as the trusted expert to guide you through this process, to give you a great outcome, and I promise you, I'm gonna work my absolute hardest to give you that outcome. If you don't feel like I can do that, then we should probably stop right here where we are. I will refund you your money, we'll shake hands, and we'll part as friends. Who can argue with that, right? And if they don't respect that, then good. Shake hands and part as friends. But the people that are very demanding, that want to control every single aspect, and they act like you're just an order taker, like you're somebody on Fiverr or somebody on some freelancer website, just there to follow a list and check a bunch of boxes, that's not the type of client that you want. So these are three things just by itself that you should be looking out for. The fourth thing that I want you to look out for and do is to vet your clients. I want you to get some references. I want you to talk to other people that they've worked with. And most importantly, and this is a testy one, so not everybody's gonna love this, I want you to pay for a subscription to a background check software. I want you to look into their past, run their name, and see what their history looks like. I don't want you to judge them on their history, because some people have horrible pasts and they've turned their whole life around. If you looked at my background check, there's probably not gonna be a whole lot that comes up there, but I have made some mistakes in my life. Their past doesn't define who they are today, but it's important to have some information, because some people that have assault and battery and really bad charges on their record, that's an indicator, especially if they're really recent. It's a way for you to kind of get a better understanding of who that person is. And if you're already seeing red flags, I'm not just gonna say background check every single person that comes into your company, but if you get red flags or even yellow flags, you need to kind of look and do a little bit deeper of a dive and get some additional information on them, because it's gonna protect you. It's gonna protect your business. It's gonna protect your reputation. And these are some ways that I've helped protect my company, and I cannot tell you how much it's saved me. There's been people that I've ran checks on that kind of gave me a weird vibe, that had written bad checks, bounced checks on people, serious crimes. And these are people that I've avoided and said, hey, thank you so much for your interest, but we're just not a good fit. So you want to vet people, especially if they've given you any kind of a red flag or yellow flag. All right, the last one, number five. It all comes down to processes. You have to have an onboarding process. In that onboarding process, you need to have them sign terms and conditions. You need to have a communication standards document that they sign and they actually go through and acknowledge that they've read it. These are really important. Having that onboarding process and having multiple people, multiple touch points within that onboarding process when you're bringing on a client, because how they talk to you, if you're a guy or if you're a gal, versus how they talk to somebody else on your team that may be of the opposite sex, can be completely different. I've had people that have downright talked very demeaning and very rude to the women on my team, and I do not tolerate that. Women deserve the same respect as men, and if you're talking down to a woman and you're a guy, shame on you. So I do not allow that in my business. I will immediately fire a client, and it's really important that you include your onboarding process and having multiple people on your team communicate with that person. And if they don't follow your process, they don't go through your terms and conditions, they don't sign the agreements, they don't actually follow the steps that you've set up, that's not the client for you. Just everything word by handshake deal or just verbally is not a process. You need to put it down on paper, you need to walk them through a process, and that's gonna be what separates the amateurs from the pros. So those are the five things that I want you to look out for when you're actually looking for a client, when you're dealing with a client, that can help you avoid these clients from hell, the nightmare clients, and the clients that are gonna get under your skin. So if you're finding this content helpful, once again, if you could please hit that like and subscribe button and even share this with a friend, maybe a friend that also has nightmare clients and you think this was funny or somehow helpful and this can help them, it would really mean a lot to me. I'd really appreciate it, because I still have three things that I wanna share that are gonna be really helpful. So let's just say you don't have these processes set up and you have a nightmare client that you have right now. Okay, there's three things that I want you to do in order to deal with these nightmare clients. Number one, I want you to fire them. Really important. Tell them that you're not a fit, that it's not gonna work, that they need to find somebody else. Number two, I want you to fire them. I'm serious, this is super important. Do not keep these nightmare clients for the money. A lot of people keep these nightmare clients because they pay well, sometimes they do, they pay well, but it's just not worth it. It's not worth the money. Go find a client that's gonna value you, your time, your team, and your talent. Number three, fire them. I think I've made my point. In all seriousness, I really want you guys to understand that this is not something that happens every once in a while. This is very common. I want you to send a nice email to these people or pick up the phone and call if you're that confident and just tell them, hey, after careful consideration, I've decided that we're going in a different direction and we're just not a fit. I'm unable to work with you and support you at this time. Or you don't even have to say at this time. It could be brief, it could be short. The less you say, honestly, it's gonna be better. I want you to remember that you don't have to defend your position, that you are a professional, and in fact, you can even block their email and you can block their phone number and you never have to hear from them again. It's pretty simple. We live in an age of technology that gives us the ability to block emails, block phone numbers, and you'll never have to hear from that person again. Unfortunately, this guy knows where my office is. I have a brick and mortar store, so there's nothing I can do, but I wanted to find ways to help you avoid these nightmare clients and keep them from getting under your skin. So if this video was helpful, make sure you hit that like button, subscribe button, share this with a friend, and I wanna make sure that you know that you're invited to join us in the Instagraphics Pro Network. It's a group on Facebook, private community of some amazing designers, amazing leaders in the motion, graphics, and web design space that are just doing amazing things. We're sharing our work, we're doing events together, I'm doing trainings, all kinds of amazing stuff that's happening in that community, and I would love to have you there. There's some questions that you have to answer in order to get into the group. If you don't answer them, I'm not gonna let you in. I'm very specific, and I'm very picky about who I want in this community. I want the best, so make sure you follow all of the questions. And when you do that, I'll be happy to let you in and welcome you into our family. So thank you guys so much for watching. I'm Adrian Boysel. I can't wait to see you guys on the next video. And until then, keep looking up.